to set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church. We need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first. Our lives, for you're our joy and prize. To see the captive hearts released, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. We are your church. We pray, revive this earth. Your kingdom here, let the darkness flee. Show your mighty life, free and life. Set your on fire, win this nation back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful. Your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in a desert place. When I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. blessed be your name. When sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. On the road marked with suffering, the pain in the offering, blessed be your name.
Together. Gracious Lord, as we gather here together, our prayer is that as we stand here and we sing these songs of praise, as we lift them up to you, Father, that we never do it with half a heart, that we never become apathetic in our worship of you and just go through the motions of praise. Lord, help us, Father, to sing these songs with all of our heart and soul so that our worship of you is genuine and is true. Pray this all in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
My Jesus, my Savior, for there's none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of shelter, tower of refuge and strength.
mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I'll sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have.
As I was preparing for this communion meditation, I looked up some things online, and this idea here that I'm going to share with you came from Stuart Powell on the Christian Standard. I kind of ran across that, and it really kind of struck me. So, he goes on, he suggests that driving a car is a great metaphor for life, right? And so as you're driving along, and maybe your week, as you think back on it, was a week where you're driving down the scenic byway. Maybe it's a river road, nice leisurely Sunday drive, watching all the scenery, watching the all the wildlife run by, right? It's a great pleasant week and whatnot. Or maybe it's more like a driving through a residential street, school buses stopping at every house, dropping off the kids. The kids are taking off running, a lot of great excitement, right? Or maybe your week was more like mine. It's urban street, people honking, trying to merge in, maybe even some unhappy gestures, right? Whatnot. But there are times where things cause us to slow down. So consider maybe a hearse is coming towards you. What happens? Or maybe it's an emergency vehicle, an ambulance. You tap the brakes, you pull over on the side, you wait for that hearse to pass. Or maybe that ambulance to pass by you, and maybe you stop and consider for a minute, boy, somebody's really having a bad day, or somebody's really hurting, right? So communion is a little bit like that. Some of the things that should just cause us to stop and pause in life, just tap the brakes and pull over. So whether your week was that leisurely wonderful drive down the scenic byway, or it was that urban street where people are honking at you and things are really busy and congested. Whatever it was, just tap the brakes for a second. Pause, pull over. Down in front of you is a communion cup. So if you're joining us, go ahead and pick that up. So Holy Communion should cause us to tap the brakes and pause for a moment. Holy Communion, we do this act in remembrance of Jesus Christ, what he did for us on the cross. We need to tap the brakes and pause for a minute and consider those things. Consider his love for us. Consider the meaning of the act. So as we remember that Last Supper, where Jesus asked his disciples to remember him, remember the sacrifice he made for us, we'll prepare the cup here. So go ahead and open the top there with the wafer. So before we do that, let's pray. Jesus, just for a moment, we tap the brakes on life, the busyness of life. We pull over and we consider the sacrifice that you made on the cross. You went to the cross for us, for me, for all of us, to take away our sins. You suffered on the cross. You died and you were buried. And the good news is you rose again and ascended into heaven. Thank you, Jesus, for that sacrifice. Dear Lord, as we prepare our hearts and our mind, we pause for a moment and confess our individual sins. consider ourselves unworthy of that sacrifice you made. We consider ourselves unworthy of the grace and mercy that God so freely gives us. But we thank you, God. We thank you, Jesus, for that sacrifice. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So as Jesus was preparing the Last Supper, he took the cup and said, "Take, this is my body." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is the blood of my covenant, of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now on until the day when I drink from it anew with you in my Father's kingdom."
Today's scripture lesson is from Mark 1, verses 21 through 28. And they went into Capernaum, and straightway on the Sabbath day he entered into the synagogue and taught. And they were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one that had authority, not as the scribes. And there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with you, you, Jesus of Nazareth? Are you come to destroy us? I know you, who you are, the Holy One of God." And Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Hold your peace and come out of him." And when the unclean spirit had torn him and cried with a loud voice, he came out of him. And they were amazed, insomuch that they questioned among themselves, saying, "What thing is this? What new doctrine is this? For with authority commands he even the unclean spirits, and they do obey him." And immediately his fame spread abroad throughout all the region around Galilee.
Well, good morning again. As always, it's my great privilege to bring you God's Word today. This morning, we continue our study of the book of Mark. And as we do, we come to chapter 1, verses 21 through 28, and an absolutely amazing interaction between Jesus and a demon. Now, this is just one of many times in his gospel that Mark shows us Christ's power to do that. And it's important to Mark that we see that power, because Mark knows that if we're truly going to believe in Jesus, if we're truly going to accept him as the Son of God, and if we're truly going to trust Jesus to break the bondage of sin in our own lives, Mark knows it's absolutely essential that we witness Christ using his great power to do that in the lives of other people. I mean, it's one thing to say that Jesus has that kind of bondage-breaking power, but it's quite another thing to actually show us that power in action. And so here in verses 21 through 28, that's exactly what Mark does. Now, that said, if you haven't already, please open your Bible to Mark chapter 1, verses 21 through 28. But before we get started, let's pray together. Gracious Lord, we're so grateful for this church and this church family and just the opportunity to come together like this and worship you and praise you and hear your word spoken. Lord, my prayer is, as it is every Sunday, that your Spirit is here, that he fills this place, that he fills me, so I preach in a way that brings you honor and brings you glory. And he's with every single person here today who's hearing your word, so when they hear it, they apply it to their lives and they share it with other people. Pray this all in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
You know, as Christians, we believe that all Scripture is God-breathed. And because we do, we also believe that every word of it's true, which means that this story that Craig just read for us about demonic possession, it means it actually happened. It's the kind of story you'd expect to see on a movie screen or maybe in a Stephen King novel, not in the Bible. And yet there it is, written in black and white in God's holy scriptures. Let me ask you something. Aside from the whole demonic possession thing, was there anything in that passage that struck you as odd? Anything that didn't quite sit quite right with you? I'll tell you what. Take a minute, if you have your Bibles, and read it again. And Jen, if you would, put it up on the screen for us. I think we have to do it in two sections because it's too big. I want you to just read it again. Okay, so once you got past the shock of it all, once you got past the demon possession, once you got past the convulsions and all the horrifying images that casts up, did anything in those verses stand out to you? For me, it did. For me, it did. Notice, please, if you would, the stark contrast between the way the demons reacted to Jesus and the way the people reacted to Jesus. Twice, once in verse 22 and once in verse 27, I believe it is, Mark says that the people were amazed at Christ's authority. The people were amazed at Christ's authority, but not the demons. No, the demons weren't amazed at Christ's authority. They were terrified by it. And so while the people were wondering, asking each other, hey, what is this? The demons were panicking, saying, Jesus, have you come to destroy us? Two completely different reactions. Two completely opposite reactions. The question is why? Why were the demons cowering while the people were wondering? I'll tell you why. Because the people didn't know who Jesus was, but the demons did. The people didn't really know that Jesus was the Son of God. The people didn't know that Jesus was the Holy One. The people didn't know that Jesus was the promised Messiah who had come to save them from the bondage of sin, but the demons did. And we know they did, because at the end of verse 24, one of the demons says to Jesus, I know who you are. You are the Holy One of God. Do you want to know something sad? As we move through the first half of our study of Mark's gospel, what we're going to discover is that the demons are the only ones who are really sure of who Jesus is. Most people didn't believe that Jesus was God's son, but the demons did. And so maybe it's only fitting that other than John the Baptist, the first testimony as to Christ's true identity in Mark's gospel doesn't come from any of the people he came to save and will one day die to save. It comes from a demon. The demons knew who Christ was, and they were terrified in his presence because they knew that he was God. They knew it. And I can say that with complete confidence because over and over and over again in the New Testament, the Bible tells us that they knew. For instance, later on in our study, Mark 3:11 says that whenever the unclean spirits saw Jesus, they fell down before him and cried out, you are the Son of God. Then again, in chapter 5, Mark writes about another very frightening confrontation between Christ and a demon-possessed man who lived among the tombs. Mark 5:7 says that when the demon-possessed man saw Jesus coming, that he ran up to Christ and he dropped to his knees. And when he did, the demon cried out from inside him, what have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? So folks, make no mistake, the demons in this world or fallen angels, whatever you want to call them, they know who Christ is. They've known since creation who Christ is. They've known since they were dwelling in heaven as holy angels who Christ is. They've known since they rebelled against God and along with Lucifer were cast out of heaven. Demons have known since the very beginning of beginnings who Jesus is. And they know he has the power to destroy them because they have seen that power and they are terrified by it. James chapter 2 verse 19 says, the demons believe and shudder. The demons believe and shudder, and yet few others did because they didn't believe. The scribes and the Pharisees didn't believe. Mark 3:22 says, the scribes who came down from Jerusalem were saying, he is possessed by Beelzebub and by the prince of demons. He casts out the demons. So the religious leaders in Israel didn't believe. Neither did the Jewish people. How do we know? Because Mark 6 verses 2 and 3 say that on the Sabbath, Jesus began to teach in the synagogue. And many who heard were astonished or amazed, saying, where did this man get these things? What is this wisdom given to him? How are such mighty works done by his hand? Is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary and brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us? And then Mark says, and they took offense at him. And so the Pharisees didn't know who Jesus was. The scribes didn't know who Jesus was. The priests didn't know who Jesus was. The people who didn't know who Jesus was. And you want to know what else, folks? For a long, long time, even his own followers weren't completely sure who Jesus was. And we know that because later on in Mark 8, Mark tells us that one night the disciples had sailed all the way across the Sea of Galilee. Only when they reached the other side, they realized that they had forgotten to bring bread. The only thing they had was one small loaf between them. And so they start bickering among themselves. Oh, no, who forgot to pack the bread? I thought you were going to pack the bread. No, you said you were going to pack it. Now what are we going to eat? And then in verse 17, Mark says that Jesus, hearing this conversation, got irritated with the disciples when he recognized that they were having a discussion about not having enough bread. You say, Scott, what's the problem with that discussion? They didn't have enough bread. Well, the problem is the disciples had just witnessed two absolutely miraculous events involving bread. One of them where Jesus fed 5,000 people and another where he fed 4,000. And each time Christ fed these huge gatherings of people by creating food from nothing. Not once, but twice, the disciples witnessed Christ create fully grown fish for people to eat. Fish that had never swam in the ocean. Not once, but twice, the disciples witnessed Jesus create bread for people to eat from grain that never grew in the ground. Folks, what these men had witnessed were creation miracles, plain and simple. Of course Jesus was annoyed. I mean, how do you not know who Jesus is after that? And so Jesus, keenly aware of this very disappointing, very heart-revealing discussion, here's what he says to them. He says, why are you discussing the fact that you have no bread? Do you not yet perceive or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Having eyes, do you not see? And having ears, do you not hear? And don't you remember when I broke the 5 loaves for the 5,000? How many baskets full of broken pieces did you take up? They said to him, 12. And the 7 for the 4,000, how many baskets full of broken pieces did you take up then? And they said to him, 7. And so Jesus says, do you not yet understand? No, they didn't understand. They didn't understand. In fact, it's not until Peter's good confession of faith in Mark 8, verse 29, that any of Christ's followers show any indication of all, at all, that they really understood who Christ was. So in the first half of Mark's gospel, the Pharisees didn't know who Jesus was. The people didn't know. Even his disciples didn't really know for sure who Jesus was, but the demons knew. And that's why in verse 23 of our text today, Mark says that the demon cried out. He cried out. It's the Greek word anakrazo. And it literally means to scream in terror. To scream in terror. And so the people were wondering, but the demons were screaming. They were anakrazo. The crowd was amazed, but the demons were terrified. Why? Because the demons knew something that the people didn't. The demons knew that Jesus was God. And they knew that God is holy. And they knew that they weren't. Folks, the demons were afraid of Christ's God-given authority because they knew that they had reason to be afraid. But the people didn't. Unlike the demons, the people were oblivious to their own sinfulness. And you know, tragically, most people still are. Most people today are oblivious to their sin and to their need for a Savior. And so most people today don't know Jesus. They don't believe in Jesus. And so they couldn't care less about his authority, let alone fear it. And so in the short time we have remaining this morning, we're going to examine four facets of Christ's authority that every Christian, every one of us, should be aware of. And can I ask you folks to please stay with me? Stay with me this morning, because not only are these elements of Christ's authority enough to make a demon scream out in terror, but if we truly believe that Jesus is who he says he is, then they should also be enough for every single one of us. It should make us to fall down in knees of reverence and in awe and in praise of this great king that we all came to worship today. All right, here they are. Here's what demons fear and we should revere: the authority of Christ's word, the authority of his judgment, the authority of his holiness, and the authority of his power. We're going to spend most of our time together on the first one, which is the authority of his word. Verses 21 and 22. They're talking about Jesus here and his disciples. It says, "And they went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath he entered the synagogue and was teaching. And they were amazed at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority and not as the scribes." Right, let me set the scene for you just briefly. Jesus and his newly called disciples arrive in Galilee and immediately went to the city named Capernaum. Now understand, Capernaum was a very beautiful but very depraved city. In fact, in Matthew 11, 24, Jesus told the people of Capernaum that it will be more tolerable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom than it is for you. So it was a wicked, vile place. But historians tell us that Capernaum was also the trade center for the entire Galilee region. It was said to have this 2-mile-long promenade, not unlike the boardwalks we have today. It was just this huge stone walkway that kind of followed along the edge of the Sea of Galilee. And just like modern boardwalks, this walkway, this promenade, was lined with all kinds of shops and restaurants and vendors and hotels. And about a quarter mile or so, about every quarter mile, there would be a fishing pier that jutted out 100 feet or more into the water. And so this was just a hustling, bustling, happening kind of place. And so it makes sense that this is where Jesus decided to set up his base camp for his ministry. And Mark says that having arrived there on the Sabbath, that Jesus immediately entered into the synagogue and he started to teach. Now Mark, who's always short on details, doesn't mention this, but Luke says that by the time that Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Holy Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside, he was teaching in their synagogues, and everybody praised him. See, apparently the buzz about Jesus had made its way up from Judea. And so by the time he arrived in Capernaum, word of his power and of his healing and of his teaching and his miracles had reached the people there. And so as you might expect, they were lining up to hear him preach. Now, Mark doesn't give us any specifics as to what Jesus taught about. And that's because Mark's focus isn't on the content of Christ's message in this passage, but rather on the people's reaction to it. Do you understand? Mark's focus is on the people's reaction to Jesus' message. And so in verse 22, Mark writes, "The people were amazed at his teaching." They were amazed at his teaching. Now, why were they amazed? Mark says, "For he was teaching them as one who had authority and not as the scribes." Now, do you see that word authority? That word authority there? Well, it is the Greek word exousia. And it literally means to speak as one who reigns. You know, like when a king would issue a decree from his throne, the king would speak with exousia. He would speak with absolute originating authority because he was the originating authority. It was his decree. It was his law. He wrote it. And so when Mark says that Jesus taught them as one who had exousia, what he means is that Jesus taught with absolutely the authority of a king, as if these words he was speaking were originating from him, as if he was the one who wrote the law. And they were. And he was. And so when the people heard Jesus preach, they were just amazed, and they were saying, "Man, this guy teaches like someone who has authority, not like the scribes." Which bodes the question, how did the scribes preach? Well, apparently not like Jesus. The scribes didn't speak with exousia. The scribes didn't speak with authority. No, all the scribes did was quote other rabbis. They'd get up in front of a group of people like you in the synagogue, and they'd say, this famous rabbi said this, and this famous rabbi said that. And so their lessons often became more about name-dropping than it was about preaching a sermon. But then Jesus comes along, and when he teaches, he doesn't quote anybody. No, he spoke with authority. He spoke with exousia, like the truth he was teaching originated from him because it did. Do you see? Do you see? And so Christ's teaching was different than the scribes. Christ's teaching was clear, not muddled. Christ's teaching was absolute, not arbitrary. Christ's teaching was logical, not mystical. Christ's teaching was meaningful, not trivial. Because when Christ taught, he didn't merely suggest the truth. He told the truth because he was the truth. And the people had never seen anything like that before. And Mark says that they were amazed at his teaching. They were amazed. This word amazed, I think it's worth looking at because it's really an interesting word in the Greek vernacular. It was a boxing term. And its roots were in the Greek Olympic Games. The word is ekplaso. Ekplaso. Do you want to know what it means? Literally translated, ekplaso means to punch the senses out of somebody. To punch the senses out of somebody. Isn't that a terrific word? Did you ever see a boxer get hit right on the point of his chin? And he doesn't go down, but for a few seconds he's stunned and he doesn't know where he is? Well, that's ekplaso. And Mark says that whenever Jesus spoke, the people were ekplaso. They were astonished. They were amazed. It was like getting hit with a Mike Tyson left hook. They just were stunned by what they were hearing. Then right after that, in verse 23, Mark says, immediately there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out. He anakrudzo, right? He screamed in terror. Now why? Why was the demon screaming? Why was it terrified? What was it that terrified this demon so much that he has to cry out? It was the authority of the Word of God. It was the truth that terrified the demon so much. The demon knew that when Jesus arrived, the truth arrived. And nothing on earth is more deadly to demons than the truth. Folks, only one thing can tear sinners away from the clutches of sin. Only one thing can liberate sinners from satanic dominion. Only one thing can break the bondage of sin, and that's the truth. And only one man is the source of that truth, and that's Jesus. Jesus said in John 14:6, I am the way and the truth and the life. And Mark says that when the demon saw Jesus and he heard the truth of God being preached in the synagogue, that he was afraid. And so he anakrazo, he screams out in terror, and for good reason, right? 1 John 3:8 says the reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. Another Greek word to throw at you, it's ergon. And it simply means a system of business or enterprise. John says the reason that Jesus appeared on earth was to destroy Satan's evil system, of which demons are a crucial part. And so in our text today, when a demon saw Jesus coming and he started speaking God's word with exousia, with absolute authority, they were terrified because nothing is more lethal or more deadly to demons than the gospel truth. And so the demon screams out. There's a second aspect of Christ's authority that makes demons shudder in fear, and that's the authority of his judgment. The first was the authority of his word. The second is the authority of his judgment. This is verses 23 and 24. Mark writes, immediately there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, what have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? Folks, demonic possession has always been around. It's always been around, but it was never as rampant and as visible as it was during Christ's earthly ministry. And that's simply because Jesus, when he was in their presence, exposed demons. And when he did, they manifested themselves in wildness and nakedness and convulsions and self-mutilation. And they always screamed in his presence. And so it was in our text today. This demon inside this man screams out in terror in the very presence of Christ. And again, I know this sounds a lot more like a Wes Craven story than a Bible story. But the reason this man is screaming is because he can't help himself. Can you imagine? He's literally possessed by demons. And as unsettling as it is, the demon is screaming through this man's vocal cords. He is controlling this man's vocal cords. And so as Christ starts preaching, the demon reveals himself and he says to Jesus, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth?" Literally in the Greek, it is, "What are we to you? What are we to you?" Isn't that frightening? This demonic spirit literally possessing this man speaks through him and says, "Jesus, what are we to you?" In other words, what business do we have with each other? Have you come to destroy us? Both Satan and demons know the plan of God. They know 1 John 3:8 we just read. They know that Jesus came to destroy them. They know they're unredeemable. They know there's going to come a time to face Christ's judgment. They know Revelation 20:10, which says they're destined for the lake of fire. Folks, Satan and his demons know how the story ends. They just don't know when. And so in our text this morning, these demons, terrified at the authority of Christ's word and at the authority of his judgment, manifest themselves and they say, "Have you come to destroy us? Is now the time?" Now quickly now, there are two more aspects of Christ's authority that make demons scream, and we're only going to have time to briefly touch on them. The next is the authority of his holiness. Demonic forces fear the holiness of Christ. Just a real quick rabbit trail, a quick footnote. Notice, please, that even in his terror, that the demon addresses our Lord as Jesus of Nazareth. And that's because it was a common term of disdain for Christ, because Nazareth was viewed as a disdainful town. And so the demon spoke of Christ with the same kind of wicked scorn as the Pharisees and the Sadducees did, expressing what a ludicrous notion it was that the Messiah could ever come from a place like Nazareth. And yet they know Jesus is God's son. When the angel came to Mary in Luke 1, verse 35, and said, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High God will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy One, the Son of God." The demons knew that. Demons know that God is holy, and the demons know that God's Son is holy. And we know they know because, like I said earlier, at the end of verse 24, the demon says it. He says, "I know who you are, Jesus. You are the Holy One of God." And that's why they're afraid. Utter evil quakes in the presence of utter holiness. And so these demons who are pure evil cower in fear in the face of Jesus Christ, who is pure holiness. And that fear is made manifest in this blood-curdling scream of this demon-possessed man. All right, just quickly. So the demons scream at the authority of Christ's word. They scream at the authority of Christ's judgment. They scream at the authority of Christ's holiness. And finally, Mark says that demons scream at the authority of Christ's power. Verses 25 and 26, Mark writes, "But Jesus rebuked him, saying, 'Be silent and come out of him.' And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying out with a loud voice, came out." Notice that there's no dialogue, no negotiation, no prayer, no exorcism. Jesus just spoke, and the demon came out. Folks, that's authority. That's power. And the demons knew one day that same power will speak them into the lake of fire forever. Because you can look, there are no exorcisms in the New Testament. There are none. Jesus simply spoke, and whether they wanted to or not, the demons left. Well, in today's text, the demon clearly doesn't want to leave. He doesn't want to come out. No, this demon wants to hold on to this poor soul that he's possessing and drag it back into hell with him. And so in one last futile act of protest, the demon throws the man into a violent fit of convulsions, and then with a loud scream of rebellion and compelled by the unstoppable power of Christ, the demon comes out. Simply remarkable, isn't it? By his own authority, with nothing but a word, Jesus cast the demon out, proven beyond a shadow of a doubt that he was indeed the Son of God. Folks, I want to close today by saying that what happened in that synagogue in Capernaum, what happened there was unmistakable. It was irrefutable. It was undisputable. Christ's authority and Christ's power were on display that day for everybody to see. With their own two eyes, they all saw it. They saw it, but they didn't believe it. And so in verse 27, Mark doesn't say they believed. No, all Mark says is they were amazed. They were amazed. Strange, isn't it? Here are these demons who are absolutely terrified because they did believe. And here are these blind people who were absolutely amazed because they didn't believe. Boy, how tragically ironic is that? Just think about what's happening here. I mean, here are these unredeemable demons that believed Christ was God's son, and they couldn't be saved. And here are these redeemable people who refused to believe that Christ was God's son who wouldn't be saved. Absolutely tragic. Tell you something even more tragic. In the end, when all is said and done, amazed people who don't believe and terrified demons who do believe end up in the same place. Because I know that I may not be the flashiest preacher to ever grace the pulpit, but if nothing else, there's one thing you can know for sure. I will always tell you the truth to the best of my ability, even if it hurts. And the truth is, it's not enough just to be amazed by Jesus. It's not. Jesus doesn't want your amazement. He wants your commitment. Jesus doesn't want your amazement. He wants your belief. He wants your heart. He wants your soul. He wants your life. Jesus wants you to take up your cross and follow him, no matter what that means to you. No matter where he asks you to go, no matter what he asks you to do. The question you have to ask yourself this morning is, am I willing to do that? Am I willing to follow Jesus regardless of the cost? And if your answer to that question is yes, or if you're already following Jesus, if you already believe, then the question is, are you willing to share your belief with other people? Those are the questions this morning. Let's pray together. Gracious Father, we see here again the absolute majesty of Christ, who's both Savior and Judge. Keep us mindful, God. If he's not our Savior, he will be our Judge. No matter how hard we try, we'll never escape a face-to-face confrontation with Jesus. Either in that hour when he embraces us in his eternal love and takes us to live with him in his own home prepared for us, or when he faces us as our judge and sends us with the unrepentant and the unbelieving to an eternal place forever separated from you and from your love. The evidence is in. The demons know it. Christ is Lord. Christ is King. Father, our prayer this morning is that the lost might know it. Yes, Father, we're to be amazed by Jesus, and we are amazed. We're amazed by his teaching and by his truthfulness and by his power and his holiness. We're amazed by his love and his mercy and his grace. But that amazement, Lord, has to be accompanied by belief. Belief in Jesus as your Son. Believe in Jesus as our Lord. Believe in Jesus as our Savior King who died in our place on a cross on a hill called Calvary. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
Well, as we prepare to close out our service today, we always finish with two songs, two praise songs to the Lord. The first one is a call to the altar. It's an invitation song. We invite you to come up, and if you need prayer, one of our elders will be up here with you. And you know, there's power in prayer. Maybe you need prayer for a loved one. The time to come forward. I know it's a long walk, short aisle, but it seems like forever when you walk up for prayer. You can have that prayer spoken out by the elders to the congregation. You can keep it private between you and the elders. That's between you and them and God. It's also a time to come forward if you'd like to make arrangements to be baptized or to join our church. The rest of us is to stand and let's worship our Lord. I thought an appropriate song today was All My Hope, because that is where all our hope is, in Jesus Christ.
Savior.
Upbeat song as we take our offering. So if you want to know how to give here, there are three ways to do that. The ushers, if they could pass the plates around, is one way. Another way, there are two boxes on the exits on the way out. You'll see them on the way out. Or you can give online as well at our website. So the rest of us, let's stand. Let's worship our Lord.
So aimless, my life filled with sin, I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Where is
Jesus, I'm thankful for my home. And I go climbing and got you back in sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
Yes, you did, because I'm out of wind, so good.
To see all of you today, it's just so wonderful to have you all here worshiping together. Just a couple of quick announcements. VBS starts tomorrow, and I've already had a couple of people approach me and volunteer to help. If you would like to help out in any way during any time from Monday through Thursday evening, please just come and see me after the service. I would love to have you help. I don't care what you do, if you just want to smile at kids and guide them through the food line or help with games or anything. It's easy stuff, and it's just a great time for everybody. I promise that you will be really tired, but really glad you did it. So please come and see me afterwards. Also, if you haven't signed up your kids, there are some registration forms in the back. If you forget, don't worry. Just bring them tomorrow night. But if you can get them signed up today, that would be great. So you can grab those at the back of the sanctuary. One more thing. We're going to keep bugging you about this until it comes. August the 14th, Feed My Starving Children. You know this. I know this. We need 30 people, so get signed up. Andy, do we have a head count yet? Okay. Only a few seats left, so if you want to go, you can't say we didn't warn you. So get signed up for Feed My Starving Children. August the 14th, Saturday. Yes. Oh, yes. Okay, if you didn't hear that, next Saturday, August the 7th, is the Iron Women are going to Dykstra Gardens, and there's a sign-up sheet in the back if you would like to go. We'll meet here in the morning, carpool, and head up there together, so it's a great time. I think it's a place that the ladies who have been in Iron Women for a while are very familiar with, can tell you about, but get signed up back there and talk to one of us, and I think that'll be it. Did I forget anything?
I have one more, but you didn't know it.
Good, all right.
Before I leave you with a benediction, just one thing. It's coming around that time of year for elder nominations, and the forms are back on the table for any member to pick up, so you'll see them back there. Otherwise, it's going to leave you with this prayer from the book of Numbers. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. We pray this all in Jesus' holy name. And God's all of God's children said...
Skilled to understand what God is will, what God us believe. I only know at his right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take him at his word and believe. Christ died to save me, this I read.